Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. The Wednesday session of the State Board of Education is called to order. I'll acknowledge that Mr. Willard and Mr. Bacon will not be here, and at some point we'll ask Mrs. Waugh to go to her chair. Motion would be in order to approve today's agenda. Moved by Kathy, seconded by Jim. All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed, 8-0. At this time, I'm going to introduce Jamie Mitchell, who is going to talk to us, give us full knowledge of kindergarten readiness.
Today. I brought some friends with me, so I wanted to introduce them to you today. But first of all, let me just give you kind of a rundown so you can know what to expect. We're going to give you an update on the Ages and Stages Questionnaires pilot. We have a recommendation to you from the Kindergarten Readiness Workgroup. I'm going to show you a proposed implementation timeline. We're going to have plenty of time for you to ask questions, and we will do the best that we can to answer them. And then, time permitting, we have an update on some of the work here at KSDE that we've done to align our early learning programs with the kindergarten readiness outcome. So that's what you can expect from us in the next couple of hours. I mean, we could keep you all day. We have enough content, but we've been told we have to limit it to 2 hours.
So that is correct.
We will do our very best. So I do have quite a few teammates here today, some people from the field and some from our staff at KSDE. So I wanted to introduce them, and I want you all to stand or wave since you're standing right behind me. So first we have Monica Mernon. She is the Director of Student Support Services at Greenbush Educational Service Center. She has been a member of our Kindergarten Readiness Work Group since the beginning and is very knowledgeable about all of the work that has taken place to date. We have Shauna Jones.
Does she happen to be anything else?
She does happen to be a state legislator, and so she will have to leave early to conduct business across the street. So she may not be here for our questions and answers. Yes. Shauna Jones is a kindergarten teacher at USD 419 Canton-Galva. She has not only been part of our kindergarten readiness work group throughout this work, but she has also participated in the pilot and is very familiar with the Ages and Stages questionnaires, materials, and online tools. We have Sandy Rempel, who is a kindergarten teacher from USD 313 Bueller. She has participated in the pilot. She has not been part of the kindergarten readiness work group, so her perspective is fresh and new from the classroom standpoint. We have Penny Stoss, who is an assistant superintendent at USD 309 Nickerson and South Hutchinson. She is an administrator who jumped on board with us and became one of the Ages and Stages trainers. And she trained her staff at Nickerson and at Bueller. And she's here to talk about the Ages and Stages from the perspective of a district administrator. And then we have Amy Blosser, and she's the Early Childhood Director from the Children's Cabinet and Trust Fund. And Amy will look familiar to you because she was the one who talked with you in August when we gave you the full day version. So I'm very honored to have these ladies here to support our efforts. We've had a couple of conference calls to get ready for today. And, you know, when you work with great people across the state and you have a common mission and vision and goals, it's like meeting old friends, even though you've never met face to face. So even though we were all quite chatty here earlier, some of these ladies met personally for the very first time about 30 minutes ago. So great people. We also have quite a few staff members from KSDE. And so I just wanted to make you aware that while I've had the opportunity to speak to you about kindergarten readiness, we have a team of dedicated people who are working hard to align all of our early learning efforts behind this board goal. And so here we've got Vera Straub-Rontier. She's an assistant director on the Early Childhood Special Education and Title Services team. We have Barb Dayal, who is an education program consultant specializing in early childhood. We have Ms. Wilbur behind the podium being shy. Oh, there she is. She's our newest hire on the early childhood team, and she's been with us for 2 whole weeks, so we're really glad to have her on board. We have Ryan Weir, and he helps us figure out money and financing and things that require numbers. And then Dean Zeitz is our fiscal coordinator, and he also helps us with the money part. So really honored to have them all here today to support our conversation as well. So because kindergarten readiness, as you well know, is one of the measurable outcomes, it has really sparked a wave of exciting conversations around the state. And I hope that I have the opportunity to share a little more with you after the question and answers about the pilot, because there is a lot of excitement in the air. There are a lot of questions, but they come from a really good place. And so highlighting kindergarten readiness and what that means for our littlest Kansans has been very, very exciting work. And so I just wanted to thank you for that decision and to let you know how honored I am to work on behalf of such a great cause. So as you know, when we talked to you in August, we have a very dynamic kindergarten readiness work group. They have been together for well over a year. And while, you know, we've added a few new members since I talked to you last, and some members have gone on to other positions, our core group has stayed the same. And so I just wanted you to be aware that this is a cross-agency work group, but we also have the input of early childhood educators, kindergarten teachers, and administrators. And so this effort has been very, very collaborative from the very beginning, and I wanted to give credit to all of these people on this list, some of them are with us today. So because I know that you probably don't need to sit here and listen to me go on and on and on, I would like to have Monica Mernon come up. She's going to start us off and talk a bit about the history of where we are today, and then Amy Blosser will come up and talk to you about the results of the pilot.
Good morning. It's nice to be on this side of the street. Thank you. Thank you very much. So again, my name is Monica Murney, and I live in Pittsburgh. I work at Greenbush. My real job, I like to say, is at Greenbush. And for some strange reason, just to get that out of the way, last year I was held captive and filed to run for the third district seat in Pittsburgh. And so the good people of Pittsburgh thought it was a good idea, so I've been here since January. And I've just been sitting over there the last 2 weeks. I'm kind of embarrassed to stand here in front of you guys and say, sorry, we haven't, you know, got an answer for all of you. But I can beg off and say I'm new, and I really don't know what's going on. So with that, now I'll go talk about something that I've
worked for a while.
Yeah. How long? A long time? What I really do know about and really enjoy working within the scope of early childhood. So my role here today is just to kind of give you from the field perspective and also a bit of a historical perspective. The funny thing about this project, and I just have to fess up right up front, I was so excited to hear about this happening, because I had thought for a lot of years that, gosh, we could really enhance what we're doing as far as data collection and looking at who kindergarten kids are when they walk in our door, because everybody has an opinion. I was just, you know, so tickled to hear that we were taking this on. And I don't remember who called me, but I was in an airport baggage claim somewhere with one of my kids. And I got this call to serve on a task force. And I was just like, you know, being like, really excited at this baggage claim, and my daughter said only you would get that much of a thrill asking to be on a task force, and because I really, really was. So the last year or so that we've spent together, you know, has been really meaningful, because to me, we really did look at this whole picture. We looked at the whole picture, and we really talked it out, you know, as some people back home would say, we really cussed and discussed it. Because we had so many different people, and I'm really pleased that the staff here at KSDE pulled the right people together. One of the things that always comes up is, you know, this idea of, you know, there are still people out there who think that who don't even think of early childhood as an investment. They think of it as something nice, something extra, something fluffy. And so, unfortunately, there are still those people out there. And sometimes there are those people out there in K-12 buildings. You know, your kindergartners are just the cute ones down at the end, and you hope nobody throws up. And, you know, it's unfortunately, we do still have some places like that. The good news is that through this process, we found out that there are fewer and fewer of those places. There are K-12 districts that just really, really recognize that they want to invest early. They also, because of the work you guys have done over the last several years, recognize the importance of data in driving good decisions and getting away from this idea of, you know, just perceptions. Kindergarten kids, I don't know why this is, but I think it's true. You know, everybody thinks they know what a five-year-old needs, because you had one, you were one, or you saw one at Walmart. And I think that this tool that where we got to and what we're bringing you today is a really nice combination of not only bringing up the workforce, but also getting good data that we can drive decisions. But more importantly, it pulls in that parent piece, or that whoever cares about the kid at home piece. It doesn't have to be the parent. It can be whoever it is. So with that, one of the things, how do I make this little, there's a lot of buttons here.
Use the down arrow.
So these were the major questions that when we got together, these were the first questions that we asked ourselves, and we set forth answering all of these. So what were the districts using? Quick answer, everything you can possibly imagine and nothing. Combination of both. So we really when we were out visiting with people in different places, you know, started asking a lot of questions, making a lot of phone calls. Some districts, you know, like with anything, were more advanced. If they had investments in their community, for example, with the community, the block grant money from the tobacco settlement, or if they had a lot of investments in Head Start, they might be using something different. We still found, pleased to say, not very many. But the old, you know, well, the kindergarten teacher made up this checklist, and we just go on the checklist. We found some very, very elaborate, well articulated systems in districts, and then we found a whole lot of, well, we use this, but what is out there? What could we be using? And that, I think, was the most important thing in these early stages, was that people from districts were genuinely interested and excited and were looking for direction. And I think anytime you're looking at kind of implementing a new system, anytime you feel that groundswell, immediately you're on the right track. So we found all different kinds of things. We found some things, just as an observation from somebody who's been hanging around in schools for a while, we let special ed do that. Are we supposed to do that? And so we found that, again, regular ed was looking for direction, but they just needed a little more of it. We also did a great analysis, thanks to Barb. She had pulled together a lot of information from other states, you know, thinking if we can copy something, you know, might be a good idea. And so the group narrowed down, and then we used rubrics, and we went through each of those and really analyze those. One of the things that we found was, well, one, a lot of states are spending a lot of money on a readiness tool. Another thing was that we just kept getting this, how much time does it take? How much time away from the kids does it take? If I'm doing this particular tool and it's an hour on each kid and I have 25 in the morning and 25 in the afternoon, you know, so we really looked at that issue of teacher time. The other thing that we rolled around was, well, maybe we just, you know, take parts and pieces of all the things we like and we create a new one. Again, compliments to the KSDE team, because they were able to answer questions like reliability and, you know, all of those things that are important but people like me sometimes don't think of. The other thing is we spent a lot of time on what do we want to collect. And we did that in the process of listening to a lot of different people. And then also kind of interpreting what people were saying. And so one of the things that we heard loud and clear was social emotional. You know, it might have been called something different from the local kindergarten teacher. It might have been behavior. It might have been maturity, whatever, you know, whatever phrase you hear. But it really came down to social emotional was important. The other thing is being able to talk the difference between developmentally, what should a kid be able to do, and then our perceived perceptions of academics, right? And so how do you get those two things going in the right direction? Because sometimes in schools, that's where we get off. Well, they're five. They should be able to, you know, do this, this, and this, and that academic. But kind of changing that conversation to, okay, let's look at this whole little person that we're dealing with here. So we came up with these. These were just got to do these. We really liked the word snapshot, and I know that might seem like a, oh, I don't know, maybe some people might say that's a mushy word, but really that's what we wanted to be able to bring to you, was a snapshot of Kansas kindergartners when they started school. What are we dealing with here? And it wasn't so much about what were they like in April, because as you all know, that's kind of when we start that process, right, is identifying who's coming. But we really wanted to know, because there can be so much growth, what do they look like that first day they walk in? The other thing that we wanted to look at is this idea that it's not just academic. We're not screening kids out. We really, truly just want to know what they look like, what the components are when they're coming in. And it was very important to the entire group that all of those items that you see listed there were included. We weren't just going to do a pure cognitive. The last piece, and we spent a lot of time visiting about this, is this idea of families and caregivers will be part of this process. Sometimes, and I can say this because I have a teaching license, I have an administrator license too, I can say this. Sometimes in schools we think we know everything, and especially we kindergarten teachers, because I have taught kindergarten, I can say this. I think that I can walk into a room and go, lay my hands upon the 25 in front of me and go, this is what we have. And darn it, I didn't have them the first 5 years. You know, maybe I should ask somebody who's spending every day with them for the last 5 years, right? Maybe I should just ask. Maybe I should know who they are. You know, crazy talk, right? And so that was core to everything that we were talking about here. Because truly, unless we had the kid in pre-K, unless they were on an IEP, we don't really know in schools who they are, where they've been, for the time before they got to us. So that was really, really important to us. This back to this idea of a snapshot. You know, Vera came up with this and it's perfect. So many times over the last 20 years in my work in early childhood, the conversations I have with school administrators and teachers is, you know, really about, are they ready? Are they ready? And I know in our community of Pittsburgh, where I'm just going to tell you a quick story about this hinge theory. Okay, so in Pittsburgh, you guys know when Andy was commissioner. I think Andy was commissioner, and we really started looking at QPA a long time ago. And we came up, you know, you had to come up with what are your outcomes, and that was kind of the first time, right? And we had a superintendent of schools in Pittsburgh by the name of Dan Nineswander at that time, and he's like, okay, we're going to do this, but we're not just going to. I know some of you are going, oh, yeah. And so Dan once told me, I have an opportunity for you to serve, and that's going to get to the end of my story. Any of you who have worked for him know that's not a good thing. So one of the things that we did in Pittsburgh was to say, let's just stop having this conversation about our kids ready for school, and let's just stop saying it, and say, our school's ready for kids. Is our school ready for whatever 5-year-olds walk in the door? Now, did that mean we gave up on any investing, you know, 0 to 5? No, it didn't. It meant we put more investments in, but it means also that we look at our entrance to our K-12 systems or our pre-K-12 systems. And so one of the things that we did in Pittsburgh was say, who else can we work with? Who else cares about this? And then also, how can we at our house being the district, be flexible enough that we're not a gate that just goes one way, but we're also swinging back and saying, where has this kid been? What experiences have they have? And then adjusting and adapting what we do in kindergarten to meet that, other than saying, this is the way, this is we do it, da 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 da. So over a lot of years in Pittsburgh, you know, we did this work. And one of the things that we found was really important is this idea of informing communities. And we partnered, luckily, with the Children's Cabinet back then, back when it was called Smart Start, and we really looked at a community effort. And in looking at that community effort, one of the things that we found in this process was that so many of the people across the state have had some kind of impact from the data they've collected because of the accountability standards in the tobacco settlement dollars, what are now called common measures, that, you know, this conversation with engaging communities was kind of like, oh, no kidding. We wish you guys would have some data. We've been collecting some data. Let's put our data together. Let's see what we can do for this little pot of kids. So this idea of not screening is the final thing that I'm going to share with you, because I can't tell you anything that has been a more screening out, a more consistent conversation with this group, is that this tool is not meant to say the kid's not ready. This is not about screening out. And unfortunately, there are some communities out there that, you know, sometimes we say another year's a gift. So what this group has really focused on is, again, looking at where the kid's been, where are we going, and what tool can we use to just grab that information really quickly. It will be, honestly, from the field, it will be a continuous conversation. When this moves forward, if you choose to do so, you know, there will be superintendents who will be calling and saying, hey, this kid scored really low on this. Can I go ahead and ask him to stay home for another year? We hope that conversation changes to, okay, this kid scored low specifically in this. Let's put some supports in there. Or if you see a kindergarten classroom where everybody, you know, 50% of the kid are scoring low on a particular piece of language development, then you know from the first day, beef it up, beef it up, beef it up. So I hope the conversations will, my guess is that's where the conversations will go. We'll have a little bit of that other stuff under this basics, you know, screening five-year-olds. I tell you that not to be a downer on that, but just know that that might come up. But again, that visual of the hinge is the most important piece. So with that, I will shush and let Amy talk about really more specific and important things. And thanks for inviting us over and letting us visit with you this morning. I really do appreciate it.
Good morning. It's great to be back with you guys again. And I'm going to share now where we've been since we spoke to you in August. And talk to you about our pilot and our plans. And now that we've gone through this pilot, we'd like to let you know what we found out. Okay, so I think we talked about this the last time, but really want to just touch real quick again about what we're calling the snapshot, and that's the ASQ3 and the ASQSE. Two are the tools that we selected for our snapshot, and comparing that to what an assessment and test would look like instead. And so we know with the ASQ3 and the ASQSE2, it's looking at developmental milestones, provides a snapshot of where a child is at the time in relation to those developmental milestones. It's brief to administer and largely observational in nature. And one thing that we don't have on this list is it also has family engagement and parent input in that snapshot. So I think you guys got to look at some sample ASQ3s and ASQSE2 tools in August when Tammy and I came to talk to you. And so just a reminder, the ASQ3 is looking at communication, gross motor, fine motor, problem solving, and personal social skills. And then the ASQSE2 is a social emotional snapshot. So it's looking at regulating emotions, interacting positively with others, and specifically just the social emotional piece. So we really felt like using both together was going to give us a more comprehensive look at a snapshot of the kindergarten readiness. So we had 37 total districts participating, which we feel like was a really good representation of the state as a whole and different sizes of communities and districts. So here is a look at the 37 that participated in our pilot. We had 189 teachers in 62 schools that participated. So some districts had more than one elementary school that participated in the pilot. 2,222 questionnaires were completed, and we had input and engagement from 2,600 caregivers and parents. So really, really pleased with the participation and the numbers of schools and teachers that voluntarily participated in this.
Yes. So that questionnaire is, you have that many students.
That many students. That's right.
The questionnaires would be of both. So essentially, I think you would divide that number kind of almost in half.
1,100.
You would have the ASQ-3 questionnaire and the ASQ-SE questionnaire.
So the pilot data reports that we were able to look at, Tammy's going to pass out, and on my slide here is just a little piece of the report, and she's going to give you a look at the full report. It is aggregate de-identified data, and it shows the percent and number of children in three different categories. So we have above cutoff, which means there's no concern. We have the monitoring zone, which means there's a possible concern, and then below cutoff, and that means there is a concern in a particular area. So it shows on your report each of the domains and where the children in our pilot were in each of those three areas. Interestingly, the lowest area for the children who participated in the pilot was problem solving, with 26% of children in the possible concern or concern range.
Did you have a question?
Yeah. Isn't that pretty normal for that age, problem solving?
It would be based on their developmental level. So they're being judged against where they developmentally theoretically should be. But
that just happened to be the area where we just noticed more kids fell in that area as far as having concern or possible concern of all the areas was problem solving. Do you want to speak to
this? Was really just more for your information. When we can collect statewide data over a year or two, it will be really interesting to see what fleshes out. But it was just interesting that already we could see just from our pilot where kids stood. So.
And then we have the ASQ-SE2 pilot data results. And Tammy's gonna pass out that one. And you can see not about 10% fell in that possible concern range, and just under 5% concern in the social emotional area. So the next part of our process of the pilot, after the teachers spent the good part of the fall gathering the ASQ data and screeners. Then they had in December to enter those into a database. And then in January, we asked those that participated, the teachers, to complete a survey and help us to understand how the experience was for them in participating in this pilot. So here are some of our survey results. We had 22 questions. We're just going to give you a little bit of highlight, and there's more data available if you'd like to look at the rest of the survey. But overall, they felt like the items focused on key kindergarten skills. They were clear and easy to understand. training was essential for this pilot and rolling this out in their districts, and that data was useful in the classroom.
Back for the board to the aggregate results by the problem solving screen. And this may be for anyone, but I know they're going to ask this at some point because I can read their minds. When you jump over to overall, you're aggregating in the concern category both the possible concerns and overall concerns, correct? And that's around 40% of the pilot participants are showing a concern in academic readiness, or I shouldn't say that, in the non-social emotional readiness, maybe that's a better, is that correct?
What are you talking about where are you getting the 40%?
Well, I'm looking at the intervals of 60 and 72 months, and one's at 41 and one's at 38, and I'm making an assumption it's close to 40% if you take the average of those two groups.
That overall column is actually parent reported. So overall, that's what parents self-report as they or parents are concerned. The other areas are how the items came out, but this form is very dynamic in that it asks parents, you know, to rate their child, and then it says, do you have a concern? And so that if we were to drill down on that by student, you could go back and say, oh, you know, Sally Sue or Jimmy or whoever, you can drill down and you can say, okay, this child appears to be on track and on target developmentally, but that parent still has a concern. And that would be very powerful for teachers to go then and talk to that parent and find out why the parent expressed a concern when the data shows that they really are developmentally on target. Does that?
I think probably I just heard some murmurs mm-hmm. when that came out of how to interpret this chart.
And here in a bit, Penny is going to show you all what the data looks like at the district and school level. These are just state reports. And so we can't, at the state level, we can't drill down on that. That's not our business. But there is a rich wealth of reports and data available at the district level that where they could drill down on that. Okay.
Okay.
We took some time at one of our meetings to look at the survey results and those that took the survey. The teachers were able to put lots of rich comments for us, and they noted a variety of creative ways that they used to engage the parents and came up with some really good ideas for how they rolled that out in each of their districts. Some of the challenges noted from the comments, including challenge engaging parents and trusting their contribution. The online tech setup and system was timing out for them, and so I think that also as part of the pilot, there was kind of a quick turnaround for some of them, and if they wanted to use the online portion, just needed a little bit more time of setting that up, and so that gave them a little bit of trouble. Feasibility and time was noted. And then knowing how to use and share the data and supporting the learning activities. And the learning activities is also part of the online system. So I think if they had a little bit more time and would have had a little bit of upfront time of preparing, they could have used those a little bit better. So those are just some of the challenges that were kind of a common theme. So now I'd like to introduce the three ladies are going to talk about their pilot experiences, and first is Shauna Jones from USD 419 Canton Galva.
Okay. Okay, I'm Shauna Jones, and I've served on the committee as the kindergarten readiness on that team, but I've also done the pilot as a kindergarten teacher. It went well. I think there were some things that I would do differently. Knowing now, I look at the pilot as a learning experience, and without that, going into it next year would have been difficult. But just having the centers set up, maybe having parents be able to come into the classroom and do it. That way we're there to answer any questions. I didn't have any problems this year, but I just think that might be more friendly for the parents. Less of a, you know, here's your paper, fill it out, give it back to me kind of thing. More of a, let's interact with your child and see where they are. So that was one big thing that I took from it. But overall, I think it went well. It was pretty easy to get all the results back. I had one parent that I had to contact a couple times to, you know, hey, I still need that. But one out of 23 isn't very bad, so I was impressed.
Good morning. I'm Sandy Rempel, and I'm kindergarten teacher at Bueller and at Union Valley Elementary. And we participated in the pilot. We jumped on board a little bit late because our administrators had received the information, and they were being kind to the kindergarten teachers and thought, well, they have too much on their plate right now. We're going to pass. Well, I got wind of the email, and I'm like, wait a minute. I want to do this because we want to have a voice, and we want to participate in the pilot. So I volunteered myself, which then after talking to Tammy, I volunteered our district. So, which, you know, it went fine. And two out of three of our elementary buildings participated. And we kind of got in at the very end. And so for training purposes, luckily my friend Penny Stoss was available as trainer of trainer, and she was able to come to our team meeting right before school started and give us the training that we needed so that we could get this information to our parents at the beginning of school. So we have the luxury at Bueller that we are given some days for pre-assessment where the parents bring the child, we meet individually with them and do a pre-assessment with them. So that was a great opportunity to give the questionnaire to the parents, answer any questions they might have. The parent filled out the socially emotional piece there, and then we gave them the other part to take home, which was a little bit tricky getting them back. And so there were five kindergarten classes, and we had the average of 20 to 24 in our classes. So getting that back was a trick. So we're going to try next year to, during enrollment, have computers available and sit down and have people there to help the parents fill it out there. And that will make things a lot smoother because it was all paper copy because the online part was not ready when we did it before. So I think that will be more convenient, and we'll get the information right away. And the other part that was the data that we were putting in. Cindy Couchman, our assistant superintendent, myself were the ones that put that in. We had a little glitch let's just say. And so getting the results back, we haven't been able to utilize that as like we will be able to in the future. So it's nice to be a part of the pilot, to be able to, like I said, have a voice and to see things that need to be worked through. So I really appreciate the opportunity.
I'm the newbie in the group, so these guys probably already know, but the process then is to bring the kids in sometime before school starts, and their kindergarten teacher does that, the assessment part on the...
Completed. The parents do it.
On the social-emotional.
They do both.
They do both, okay. Right there in the classroom, or is it all take home and do?
It could be either way, whatever works.
Okay.
It can be online, or it can be... parent just
so there's not an education professional looking at these kids assessing. She's shaking her head yes. There's not a trained educational professional assessing whether or not they know.
Right.
And that's one piece that my kindergarten teachers had a problem with. Uh-huh. To totally depend on the parents filling this out, not being defensive that we're doubting their parenting ability and that kind of thing. But to to take that information and utilize with the first information we get with Ames Web or pre-assessment information and use that with it.
The ages and stages questionnaires are valid and reliable, and it's proven that when parents complete it, 90% of the time what the parents report agrees with what the education professional will report. And so I can provide a lot of other information about the validity and reliability of using parent input, but we also, moving forward, would build some decision trees and business rules for just to help teachers and administrators to know what to do if they do get information back from a parent where they just don't see the commonalities. We would need to build in some decisions and how to approach a parent and have really rich conversations about where a child really is.
Yep. That's just a teacher control thing, because once that was discussed with us and we were able to talk to the teachers about that, they understand and realize, and especially seeing the results, the validity is great.
Well, how many schools in Topeka did this? Because I'm guessing you don't get 23 out of 24 in Highland Park Central like you do in a small town.
We had two elementary schools here in Topeka that were part of the pilot.
And what was the participation rate?
I would have to go back and look at that particularly.
Because, I mean, if this is our plan, I'd like to know they're doing it. And I'm guessing if you're leaving it up to the parents to do it in some of our schools here in town, it isn't happening.
I can get further data on the Topeka schools in particular, if you would like.
Can I address that?
Yeah.
We've been doing ASQs for my prior position for 5 years prior to this. And so what we did is when parents didn't return the ASQs, we actually allowed the teacher or the staff to do the ASQ on the student. You can do that. There are some questions on the questionnaire that a teacher or a staff member cannot do. For example, does your child sleep through the night? But so you just leave off that question. But ASQ is built in a way that if you drop off that question, it allows you to rescore and reformulate how that scoring is done to give you an accurate score. Quite truthfully, we're in a rural, low economic area, and our rate was probably about 97% return rate. But we do give the teachers the option, after they have the chance to know the kid, to do it themselves. We also, my first year we did this, which was in McPherson, our teachers had the same exact concern about the parent issue. And so I said, well, fine, give it to the parents, and you also take it at the same time, mm-hmm. but don't look at them. And so they did that. And then I actually had our paraprofessionals that were in the rooms score both sets of assessments, and they aligned almost exactly.
Yeah.
Every once in a while, we had a parent who had really rosy glasses, or we had a parent that was super critical of their child. But we sat down and we talked about it, and we went, well, wait a minute. That also tells us something mm-hmm. about the family dynamics.
Sure.
So the ASQ and the parent component, is that okay? I mean, did you want me to go ahead?
No,
you guys
I
are done.
Second, but I think the online piece is really going to help with that too. Yeah. And especially if you have that available to them during an enrollment, you can, you know, just get those parents and you can help them with it. And I think the getting those back.
But I just think there's a big difference even in rural, low economic. It's a community that's different than this community.
Yeah. I agree.
A quick thing. Sure. Because the task force, we talked about this a lot, and we had folks from Kansas City, Kansas, there, and, you know, the issues with language and
sure.
you know, cultural norms. You're asking me these really personal questions about my baby here, you know. And so one of the things that we know about the ASQ, because we've used it for so long in Kansas and other areas,
somebody, yeah, thanks for posterity, because it'll be really important. One of the things that we have found over the years is there always is that we're not going to get it back, and then the second piece is, you know, what do they really know, because they aren't trained professionals, you know. And that kind of gets back to that, you know, that slide that I showed with the bullet of, you know, sometimes we need to let that go. The beauty of the ASQ is there's so much data behind it saying that, yeah, you will have these outliers, but in general, the 90%, you land right in there. The other part of this that we haven't discussed that we found in the early childhood years, the 0 to 5, sometimes, so just as a quick example, in Pittsburgh, we use the ASQ. We had a child care center, you know, 250 kids under the age of five on any given day. Plus, we worked with about another 250 who were in home child care or in preschools out in the community. And what we found was we had caregivers report. So their child care provider reported. And what we found was it not only brought in the data, but it also reminded those who work with kids, oh, I had forgotten that a five-year-old should be able to do this or not be able to do it. That's what we ran into more. We had too high of expectations for kids. And so it's almost used, again, as a reminder to staff. And I didn't mention that earlier. But we really, really did try to address that issue that you brought up with in our training groups of saying, okay, if you send it home in an envelope, it's probably not going to come back. Just accept that. Right? So what are other creative ways you can do it? And then in those trainings, people came up at the local level with so many great ways. Oh, we have a basketball or football night where everybody comes. Or in some of those more urban areas, they were doing just super creative things. Their case managers or their social workers or whatever they had on staff, they were, you know, calling families or texting them and saying, hey, I'd like to know more about Susie. And once you approach a family that way, they're just really darn happy to share anything about their kid.
Yeah, it's just, well, I mean, when you have a situation where you can't even get the parents to bring the kids to school.
Right, sure.
So, I'd be interested to see the Topeka results.
And I found it really interesting that, you know, you actually gave us copies and we looked at it. But Ann wasn't with us, so can somebody make sure that she gets copies?
Absolutely. And I'll speak to Ann's question also, being from Topeka, and previously I was a Head Start director in Topeka. I was previously the Head Start director in Topeka, on the east side of Topeka, and so one thing that this group really looked at was what the early childhood community was using. And so for many of the parents, if they've been through a Head Start program, they've seen these tools. This isn't new to them. But also talking about that it's not going to look, the rollout isn't going to look the same in every district. In my Head Start program, we sat down one-on-one with parents because there's literacy issues. There's other barriers to them filling it out themselves. And so there's just going to be some different strategies that districts are going to have to use to engaging those parents into helping them to complete it. So,
a little bit of our strategy at USD 309, we're a lot like Sandy's program in at Bueller, is that we did ours prior to school starting. The online version was not available yet, but we decided it was worth it to do it before school. So, because if we're going to do the pilot, we wanted to make sure we had that information to use. And so that's what my position, what I'm here today is to show how we used it. I'm Penny Stoss. I'm Assistant Superintendent USD 309 Nickerson South Hutch. I was formerly Early Childhood Director for USD 418 in McPherson and Head Start Director for McPherson and Marion Counties. So I come with ASQ background, using it for quite a few years. And so I wanted to make sure we had a jump start, and we did it prior to school starting. So what my teachers decided to do is they have the pre-conference with parents and teachers before school starts. And they took the student in to do their own personal screening for readiness skills, you know, the things, the checklist that typical kindergarten teachers do. The parent sat in the hall or in a side room, I believe it was, with a table, and they filled it out while their student was in with the kindergarten teacher for that 20 minutes. So that one was returned right on the spot. Then the other form, which would have been the ASQ3, because some of that it would be the cognitive, some of that you need to ask your child some questions or have them do a little writing to see if they can do it. So they sent that one home with the parent when they left that conference, and they came back with it, and they just sent it back that following week. That might be why we had such a high return rate, because they actually had a meet and greet with the teacher and a little had a little visit about what we were up to. One of the things, again, we've been talking with our teachers about, oh, the parents taking the survey. Well, here's the deal. We're always talking about parents are the first educators. We're always talking about how we want to develop relationships with our families and our parents, but this first time we have an opportunity to let our parents be the expert on their child and give us the information that they already have from the prior previous 5 years before we have them, we want to throw up all the road barriers and blocks and say, well, you're not the experts. Well, yes, they are. They are the experts of their children. And they do have a definite wealth of knowledge of what that student is coming into your classroom with. Whether it's their perceptions or not, it's still valid. And if we're going to value them as partnerships in education, that is one of the main things I thought we got out of this kindergarten ASQs, is those parents and our teachers were able to develop a relationship, a trusting relationship, right out of the gate, where they were both taking a look at data, parents' data and teachers' data together, to decide what is the best educational route for our child. I'm going to share with you a little bit about what we did with the results. Now, when we get an ASQ result data back, it actually comes out in two different forms, and all you can pull it any way you want. You can get it by classroom, you can get it by building, or I can pull it as a district if I want to take a look at the numbers as a district. You can get it as a PDF form, which is like this great big beautiful chart with all these columns and the names and all of this stuff. It's pretty muddy, but it has a lot of information. Or you can pull it down as an Excel spreadsheet, and then you can play with the data. This is not a chart that is developed from ASQ. This is my own personal chart of what I wanted to do with the data. So what I did is I took that Excel spreadsheet, I cleaned out the stuff that I didn't want, that I thought would muddy up the information, like the birth date, when they took it, and so forth, and I hid those cells, or I hid those columns. And then down here at the very bottom, you see those little gray spots at the bottom? Those are actually students' names that I have dacted out. This is a actual class report that we shared. This is a social-emotional report, and we did the same thing for the ASQ-3, or the cognitive report. And this is a particular class, and it shows where each student is with the rest of the class. I have put a norm line in there, and then I also put the cutoff line in there. I actually put those in there. That is a chart that I created out of an Excel spreadsheet that ASQ provided for me to use in any way that I want. So in this ASQ-SE, the one thing that's kind of confusing, and you have to keep switching your brain back and forth, in the social-emotional, you do not want to have a high score. If you have a high score, that means you're not doing so well. So, but in the cognitive level, you want to have a high score to show that you're sharp. So this is why you're going to see these at the bottom. That's good. You want them to be below. The lower they are in a social-emotional score, the better they are. That means they're not doing activities that would alarm you, social-emotional activities that might be different from other peers. So that's a little bit about how we did that. And I did this same chart with every single classroom and as a district by classroom and for the cognitive, but I thought you only needed to see one sample. Any questions on that chart? Good. Then from those charts, our teachers get together in PLCs, professional learning communities, for 30 minutes a week with their building principal, and they do their MTSS planning. Well, all that other information gets too muddy, and so I took the information. Again, this is something I created using those Excel spreadsheets. You can see over the side I've dacted out the kids' names so that you wouldn't see those. And this one is a cognitive chart this time, and you can see across the top the categories that are tested on the cognitive, the communication, gross motor, fine motor, problem solving, and personal social. And then what I did is our teachers are really used to seeing things like Ames-Webb, or NWA MAP assessments. And in those assessments, what they do is they color code kids so that you can spot them really, really quick, so that when you're in a 30-minute PLC and you can decide what strategies you're gonna do for what group of kids, or you can group the kids, they group them by colors. So red meaning, okay, these are high level, high need kids that are gonna be possibly tier two, tier three kids. Yellow, monitoring, might put them at tier two, tier one, might just watch them for a little bit. And green, obviously, are the kids that are performing at or above their age level. I did not put the green in because obviously that would be really muddy. But this is what I created for my classroom teachers so that when they sat down with their principals, and you can see this is Mrs. Berridge's class, she could sit down and she could quickly see from the, this is just one source of data, mind you, she could quickly see, ooh, okay, I have a kid that might be, that's having some problems with communication. Maybe I need to bring in the speech pathologist to come listen to him. Or maybe I've got this one, well, the same one that's below in communication with all this monitoring. Maybe I better take a look at him and put this student on a student improvement team. Now, you're not going to want to go to a definite immediate referral, especially at kindergarten level, because, again, we don't know all. This is just one piece of data. But it also tells you which parent or which students that we want to be watching right from the get-go. And so this is very valuable information. It's a quick look. And, again, I created it using the spreadsheets. And I think I have a sample for the social-emotional. Yep, I do. On this one, again, because social-emotional is you want a low score, it gets really confusing. So I made sure I left in, here's the student scores are on that far. To me, it's left-hand column, I guess. Yeah, before left-hand for you too. The cutoff and the no concern. I left those scores on there purposefully because you can be above the cutoff or monitoring, but what about those kids that are kind of in between and then you can't remember how close were they to that cutoff? So who should I be really watching? So I'm thinking like midway through, you see this kid that's at 50. He's just kind of hovering in the middle of monitoring and maybe needing a problem. So maybe needing assistance. So that's why I left the cutoff and norm score, no concern score on there for our teachers to have a quick reference. And again, they have a 30-minute PLC. They need to get in there, get out, and make some decisions and group kids. So that's the reason for this chart. Then when we take our data to our school boards, we want to bring the data down even a little or make it a little wider for them because they don't want to see each individual kid or classroom or and so forth. And when we're doing our data days or data reports to our school board, we're doing everything from pre-K all the way up to ACT and our clearinghouse data for post-secondary. So we want everything kind of condensed. So this was just a real quick slide that we showed with our school board. And this is the whole district. You'll see we have Nickerson Elementary, South Hatch Elementary. I will say we have 5 kindergarten classes, about anywhere between 75 to 100 kindergartners. And then USD 309. And so probably now looking at this, I'm going, I probably should have did this on the optimistic side, not the pessimistic side, because here I showed who was not ready instead of who was ready. So I'm going to fix that next year. I realized I looked at this later and I went, what did I do that for? But when you're doing a bunch of charts and you're doing them quick, you're thinking. So you can see Nickerson and Elementary and South Hatch Elementary, the percentage of students that they felt that on the ASQ 3 or the cognitive test were not ready. Pretty small numbers, actually, and overall 16%. What that tells me is our pre-K programs are doing a really good job. That's what we thought. We thought, hey, they're doing better than we thought they were, and that's really good. Because, you know, you can make jump conclusions to things, and we found out they're doing pretty well. Now, if you'll see Nickerson socially not ready, you have 0 at Nickerson. I'm going to tell you right now, I have a kindergarten teacher that would argue that 0 score because she knows she has a couple. Come to find out, we looked at it. Those were the couple parents that didn't score them, so she went back in and scored them herself, and she does have some kids with some social needs. But, again, socially, most of our students were ready. And I think that was it. Any questions on any of those? Just to let you know, we really are using the data, and there are very great ways. Yes, the state's going to use the data, but as a district and as our school, as our teachers, they're going to use the data too. And I'm sorry.
Remind the board that the speaking order application is working, but Sally, you're.
Oh, okay. I haven't. I'm sorry, I haven't loaded mine yet, Jim. the data you're getting is not broken out into those that went to preschool and those that haven't.
We have not done that yet. Now, when I was in McPherson, we did a lot of work with our power school, and we went back through, and did a little questionnaire when the teachers met with the the parents, we asked them, we had our kindergarten teachers ask them, did you have preschool? And then we asked them, was your preschool with our school district or was it an outside? And then we put a little toggle in Power School, and that we could check mark if they had preschool and if it was a USD at that time 418 preschool. And now, well, this year they will have had 4 years of data so they can compare. And that would be my plan to do in my current district also, now that we're doing this. And then when we're doing this full blown next year, is we're going to do the same thing so that we can track students that had preschool, students who had preschool that were in our buildings, and students who had no preschool. So we're going to track that data. But we were doing that at USD 418, and I wish I could rattle off that information to you right now, but I can't recall it.
Okay.
But yes, it is possible.
Okay. Commissioner, is that not something, some data that we might need? Or are we just using all national data on preschool?
Well, I think it's certainly data that Nickerson needs, that the school district would want to look at, mm-hmm. because the conversation that this data will drive is a community conversation about how do we help every student arrive ready for kindergarten as a community. So I think that's what you want to drive. I don't think we would have, data for us would just be to look at and make some judgments about. But I don't think we necessarily need that data. They need it to have this community conversation.
Yeah, if we had data, I apologize. Like in McPherson, then what we started looking at is our child care centers, our other pre-K programs, and started talking about having partnerships and relationships with them so that they understood our curriculum at the district level and what can they do, and started partnering with our local agencies.
I guess what I'm thinking, Commissioner, is that data might help us in advocating for preschools, and it might show us data where certain parts of the state might need to beef up preschools. I guess that's what I'm thinking.
It may also show, though, that certain preschools in certain districts need to be beefed up.
Often. Right.
And I think then you're going to get into a quality discussion. I don't know. I mean, we have to think through that, Sally. Because I think that data is really useful at the local level. I think we'd have to be careful how we use it at the state level. But you certainly want to know, in Nickerson, as an example, how many students are arriving, as Penny shared with you, how many students are arriving emotionally, socially, and cognitively ready for school. And then she's describing how they would use that data with their community.
May I say something? If it is decided that the state wants to drill down to that level of data as far as separating these scores out by those who had preschool and those who did not, we can build that into these questionnaires so that parents answer that there and it's collected. For the pilot, we did not do that because we were just testing out the initial materials. So I would say that we can be flexible if we choose this tool. We just did not do so with the pilot, but that would be your decision as to what data you want to collect.
I would be concerned with anything we collect is public. I would be concerned about collecting data that can be used to rank schools when the purpose are to rank areas. Because the purpose of this is to see where kids are so we can meet their needs. And I agree that it would be important to know where resources need to go, but I also don't want to open up the opportunity for judgment calls, inaccurate judgment calls to be made or data to be misused.
I see that, Jim. My thinking is a little more global. We have people all the time asking us what they can do to help in their community schools. And maybe their community, like you said, it could be used on the local, but maybe what their community needs is for somebody to step up and do a preschool. And if we had, of course, that would be on the local level again. But, you know, I had a gentleman ask me this week what can the community do or how they can help statewide with our, and if we had that data, they could have looked at where preschools are needed and they would have that data to use.
Well, obviously, this is a discussion that needs to continue because there are, I think, valid points on both sides. Anne.
Yes, thank you. I noticed in way back it said that 30% of the teachers didn't find this data helpful in the classroom. So how can we address that?
When our work group looked at that data, what we found was that in an effort to roll out a pilot with a very short time frame, we did not go as deep as we should have with the training. We did an initial training of here's the tool, here's how to administer it, here's how to upload the data, here are some ideas for engaging parents. But what we did not do at the time of the surveys was show districts and schools how to use those reports and what information was available to them. Based on this survey feedback, we went back in February then and did a couple of webinars and answered quite a few questions. And what we found was that many of the schools had done the pilot, they'd entered the data, they had looked at it, you know, one-on-one, but they hadn't really seen the reports. They didn't know the richness of the data that was available to them at the local level. So I will say that the pilot went really well. We did learn some lessons for the future. So how to train better.
So if you think if you ask the teachers that question again, you'd get a better response?
I think that every year that we use this, we would continue to survey teachers to find out what their needs are and how we can best meet their needs.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Steve Roberts.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Your data really isn't data the way you want it to be. You're making up the data, and there's biases built in. It just is. And God love you for the work that you want to do. And I've heard some very good things here today about how parents really are the experts and how this information can help us build relationships with parents. And I want to do nothing but bolster you in that effort. But the data that you want to share and use and utilize is not that good a data when we take a survey. It's biased. It's naturally biased. It's inherently biased. And so these efforts to say we're going to use this data to manage our programs is misguided at best. I'm just going to leave it there. We have many discussions to have on this issue. Thank you.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Okay. Kansas has an aspirational goal that we are heading to meet. We want each student that enters kindergarten to be 5 and socially, emotionally, academically prepared for success. So that's our goal. So how are we going to get there? We need this consistent statewide data for our decision-making processes. So that's why we chose the ASQ, and going forward, that's our hope, is that can help us with the decision-making. So our recommended action is the Kindergarten Readiness Work Group recommends that the Kansas State Board of Education approve the Ages and Stages questionnaires to become the measurement tools used annually to collect kindergarten entry data in every district.
So to summarize and to just let you know what next steps might be, first of all, all of these implementation
lines are asterisked because it really is to be determined based upon your leadership and guidance for this work. And so the first thing on our to-do list was to present this information to you, the State Board of Education. Moving forward, when we think about what would need to take place in order to put a consistent tool out there, KSDE would have to engage in a request for proposal process. That is the state's way of making sure that we are good stewards with state funds. So we would want to go through that official process to see, are there other products or vendors out there that can provide the tools that we need at a competitive or a lesser price. A vendor would need to be selected. Contract negotiations would need to take place because, of course, we would negotiate the best possible price. And then, you know, if we could get through all of those things this spring, we would begin ordering materials and shipping them and begin a trainer of trainers. We're thinking that based on the lessons learned from the pilot and those survey results, that we would want to make sure that we really built in adequate and deep training. And so we anticipate that the fall of 2017 would be that phase one training for kindergarten teachers, which would include here are the tools, here's how to use them, here are ways to build relationships with parents and engage them, here's where to put the data. And then in the spring of 2018, that training would include, here are the reports, here's the data that you have available to you locally. Again, doing that in a trainer of trainers model. So we would ask districts or regions to send somebody to have the really deep training, and then those people would be commissioned to go out to their local districts or their local regions and do that training with kindergarten teachers, instructional coaches, whoever they believe would be the best to receive that training, with the idea that in fall of 2018, we would have the first statewide data collection. And each year, around 37,000 kiddos show up for kindergarten each year. And by fall of 2018, having everything up and going, all systems go, and having that first wide data collection. That really is the very first step. Is having data in place so that decisions can be made, and decisions certainly about what kind of data we want at the state level, and then what kind of data districts have and how they might choose to use that. We want to empower the districts to use the data. We're not going to require that. So just so you know that this is the first of a possible to-do list.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I kind of want to respond to Steve's comment. This data, which if you look at our five measurable outcomes, this data I see as qualitative data, not quantitative data, which is different. I think you mentioned it was seen as determined to be reliable and valid.
Yes.
So it is a different type of data. My folks in the math world probably wouldn't think it's quite as valid or reliable, and I respect that. But when we look at some of our other measures, I look at social-emotional growth that's measured locally. That'll be qualitative data. Kindergarten readiness, which we're speaking of today. Individual plans of study, qualitative, maybe some quantitative, because we could maybe say we'll be looking at, does that lead to some career choices and positive career choices. High school graduation, we can certainly do that quantitatively. And post-secondary, we can do that quantitatively also. So I think we've got some of our measurable outcomes that are going to be qualitative data. It's different, and we all have to know that it's different, but it still can help us. The other thing that I like about it, which I know will cause some issues, but we are valuing the input of our parents. And sometimes as educators, we don't do that as well as we should. So I think there's a real positive component of that. I would like to move that we take the recommended action.
Okay, a motion has been made. Is there a second to that motion? Sally, second. Now there's time for discussion. Janet.
I wonder.
You may speak.
I not disagree with anything, but hopefully this will receive information item. And I believe, according to our policies,
we're supposed to receive it 1 month, and unless we vote.
I believe you're correct.
I just, as a policy person,
we discussed this yesterday.
So,
yeah, according to our policy and precedent, we receive 1 month and take action the next. We can vote to override that, but that's with the majority of the board, and we've done that a couple of times.
Yes.
But your point is well taken. And Sally, you have the next. You're on here twice.
I know.
She wants to talk two times.
That's to make up for when I didn't push it before. Mr. Chairman, I think that I might like to move the motion on however we do it to go ahead and vote it this time, because we had a workshop on this before and we have talked about it. And so I'd like to see if we can get the vote.
Would need to be to suspend the rules and take up action on this.
That's what I move, Mr. Chairman.
Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second.
Dina Horst seconds that motion. We are now only voting. We're not voting on the original motion. We're voting on the motion to suspend the rules to allow us to vote on the original motion. Further discussion? Kathy? You're still on here twice. Sally, so I'm going to skip you.
I give my time to Kathy.
I would ask you, would it be advantageous to have an extra month to begin the implementation of this if we were to suspend our action and go ahead and vote today?
I will leave that to your discretion. I will say that we do have a very aggressive timeline, and if we want to get things in place as far as training goes, we do need to go through this request for proposal process, and that takes a minimum of 45 days because it does have to be posted for 30 full days. That being said, we can begin the request for proposal process. We don't have to accept those proposals. I really leave it at your discretion. I want you to do what you feel is right, and I'm not going to say one way or the other.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Seeing
Mr.
no
order.
Yes, sir.
I'm not logged in on this, but my question would be: is well, if we were to approve this, would we? Are we taking the option away from those districts that are already using a quality product, or do they have flexibility? I mean, do they have to use this one?
I think that's a valid question after when we start talking about the motion. I have the same question.
Okay. I'm sorry. I jumped ahead.
Okay. Ann?
Yeah, my question's on the next question.
Okay. Well, we're going to vote on whether or not to suspend the rules now, and then we'll – evidently, we're going to have a vigorous discussion after that. Okay, I see nothing else on this. All in favor of suspending the rules, please raise your hand. 1, 2, 3, 4. All opposed? That would be 7-1. Now, that motion carries. And now, Jim.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Is this going to be the state model, or are we going to allow flexibility for districts to continue with their own product or processes that are currently in place?
Yes, to both. And let me explain that. We need consistent statewide data, and that means a consistent, the same tool. Now, if districts are using other things that they get a lot of value out of, and we're not going to say that they need to stop that, But we want the same tool to be used across the state for this kindergarten entry snapshot. That's what the Kindergarten Readiness Work Group is bringing to you today.
Okay. Second question. How much time does it take to do this?
I'm going to defer to my colleagues. I know what I've heard, but they have actually done it. So wave at me about 20 minutes for each one. So 20 minutes for a parent to sit down and do the ASQSE, and then 20 minutes for the ASQ3.
So for class of 24, you're going to be talking about 12 hours, or 8 to 12 hours?
That's where we would want to be really specific in the training of what kind of model would make the most sense with each local district.
Okay.
It's the parents, though, remember?
I'm all for it. I'm just trying to be clear, because my next question is, we talked about cost. Who's going to take care of the cost? Are the local district going to pay it, or are we going to pay it, or who's paying for it?
We're looking for money. We're applying for grants. We would like to provide it to every school in our state at little to no cost. I vote for no cost. We're still working on that piece.
I think they're doing that across the street, aren't they? Little to no cost, but looking for.
The last question right now is an unknown.
Yeah, they're going to pay right now. That's what I would. If we were to pass this, we're not passing it with any funding associated with it. So the intent would be that
the intent would be
to get them the lowest price, but ultimately this would be a district cost, because right now we don't have the money. Maybe if we had the money in the future, we would take this up.
We'll let Brad talk now.
We got those money people in the back.
We can't answer that right now until we put the RFP out. But our goal is, much like we did with individual plans of study, buying down the cost of career cruising. Now, the difference is we allowed them to use career cruising or some other. The difference with this is the recommendation of the committee is that everybody uses the same screener, so what we collect is accurate. And what we collect as a state right now, we're just looking for a numerator and a denominator. 72 out of 100 kids showed up, you know. Now, we can always add more, but we can't get much beyond that, or even that being valid if it's not the same instrument or tool that's being used. But our goal is to get the resources through an RFP to provide this to every school district. We won't know that until we get an answer to an RFP.
Earlier, when we did IPSs, we had a range. We knew that small districts were paying more and large districts were paying less for different products based on per pupil costs. Are we going to be doing a statewide RFP for this? Are we doing the same kind of administrative RFP?
We will be
doing it for districts.
We will be doing an RFP to be able to provide this for every school district, and we want to be able to buy that cost down. We might be able, if we get it down far enough, be able to incur that cost in the beginning, but we won't know that until we know what the cost of it is.
So what's the range of cost now? Any idea?
I can share with you how much it costs for the pilot, but I would need to do that in a closed session because we are under contract with the publisher to not disclose the discounted amount that they gave us.
We have people doing ages and stages right now.
Right. The catalog price for each kit. Okay, so an ASQ kit per building, the catalog price is around $475, and then it would be the same for the social emotional. Now, whether schools needed the Spanish version or the Chinese version or the German version, you know, those kinds of things, you know, would be.
When you say it's $400 a package, what does that mean?
Well, the thing is the startup cost.
24s or
the startup cost would be the most. So once a school had the kits, then that's their initial cost, and then we would have a statewide subscription to the online service, which is very, very minimal. I mean, the statewide service is around $400 a year. So once materials were out in schools, that would be the initial big cost.
and then the training, and then the maintenance of it is really, compared to a lot of other things, is very, very minimal.
Okay. I'm just, I'm
so that, just that not would be, into an unfunded that would be, mandate. That would be on the high end. We would work to negotiate that. And you're right about the, yeah, the unfunded mandate would be, I'm sorry.
Yeah, go ahead, Randy. I'll get to you.
I think if you go forward with this, remember, you still have to vote to accept
the
vendor on the RFP process. You can still stop all this at that moment because you don't like the cost, you don't like who's paying, et cetera, et cetera. What you're authorizing is for the department to go out to RFP and bring that back to you as a possible solution. That's really what the motion would be. And then if it comes back, you can decline to put that in place, just like you did on career cruising. It has to come back to you to validate that. Now, as Tammy said, your major cost is a classroom kit that would be applicable for several years until that kit wears out, or
it's almost a building. It would be a building kit,
almost like a textbook adoption in some ways, and that's why we say, well, maybe it's possible we look at some grant sources or some other ways to do it, not just us. We look at us too, if that cost came down, because it's really most of it's a one-time cost. The ongoing cost is very, very minimal.
One thing I might add is we're getting calls from school districts continuously that we're telling them to hold off because they're wanting to go out and buy a tool. Yeah. And we're telling them hold off until this board takes some action because we don't want you to go buy something that the committee says is not aligned with what, because we don't want to collect how many kids in Kansas are showing up if everybody's using something different. And that's the recommendation, doing a different tool, because there's no need of even collecting that if it's not consistent across districts. So districts are looking right now to go buy something, and we want, the recommendation is that they all use something that was piloted. We believe the committee will tell them what they need, and we can possibly, through an RFP, get that down to little, if nothing, to them. And that's where we're at right now. And Randy's right. Once we get that, then that's when the board would then make the decision.
Thank you.
And the timeline would be not for this coming fall, but for the next fall.
Right. Correct.
So,
yes.
So there's a year.
We want to make sure that we want to make sure that people are really comfortable with the materials and the online pieces, and they know all about it before that statewide data collection. Yes.
Thank you, Ann.
I don't think we have a motion on the floor right now.
Yeah, we do.
We do. Well, we voted the first time, but I don't think anybody made the motion again. Which it was not a substitute motion, so that does not put us back on the first motion. We need a motion. So,
Kathy? Yes.
So that, as a clarification, then that motion would be what's on the paper, which means every school does it. It would be a requirement, right?
Can you put the motion, the recommended motion, on the screen, please? Thank you.
In every district, which I think is good. I mean, I think we're right. We do need consistent data. We need it statewide, but I think it even puts the onus more on us to make sure this doesn't cost districts and we somehow get this cost covered. But in with that said, I support the motion. Thank you.
Peggy, who seconded the original motion?
I did.
Sally, are you still doing that?
We haven't had a second on Sally's motion to suspend the rules.
Yeah, we did. We already voted on that.
Dean.
Okay, are you seconding it again, Sally?
Yes.
Okay.
I heard you.
Steve.
Thank you.
Chairman, I'm going to be the lone wolf on this vote. It's shaping up to be. It's not the first time that I'm a single vote against the tide. But I want to just reiterate that it's not always good for everybody to sing from the same hymn book, for want of a better phrase. I think wanting kids to be ready for kindergarten is laudable.
Makes it sound better at church.
And I think making sure we all have the same data is not. And I don't know how best to convey this, but it seems to me that what I should relate is a conversation I had with a parent who was helped cleaning up. We had Teacher Appreciation Week. I was working in Spring Hill. I think it's okay to say the district. And this was a parent who had three children in the district. She was a really neat gal. She's going to go to law school next year, going to start law school. Married with three kids, volunteering to clean up after the teachers in the break room. After we had pizza for Teacher Appreciation Week, and we were talking, you know, I just engage people, you know, what do you think about this and that? So what do you think about pre-K? Oh, I'm against it. Well, why is that? Because kids need to play at home. Now, this was a mom who's fairly well off. She's going to pursue a career in law. She was just really adamant to me about how we need to let kids play. And my own kids, my own experience, I was able to be with my kids when they were 3 and 4 years old, and they stayed at home, and they got a really great education. And what I would like to see this board entertain is the idea that we don't want the same rubric for everybody at this age. We don't. Because some families will do better by just keeping their kids at home. Some, we want to encourage those who are natural teachers to be homeschoolers. We want to do that. And so I see some of the things that are being talked about today as being beyond laudable, terrific. We want to build these relationships with parents, and we want to engage the community. What I know from history, what I know from reading books like this, is that's not what we do. We say we are the experts, and you need to fill out this form so that we know what to do with you. And that's what I'm against. And I know I'm a single voice here today, but that's my perspective, and I have to stick to it, and I appreciate you listening. Thank you.
Thank you.
I went to one of the trainings at Greenbush. I didn't, was not, because of conflicts, was not able to stay all day long. I happened to have a 5-year-old granddaughter. And so, based on, you know, a little bit of knowledge is very dangerous. So I had, you know, I went to part of a training, so I was the expert, you know. So we went and we did that with my granddaughter, who is her mother, and did that with our granddaughter, and it showed, it gave us some valuable information. It's kind of a fun thing to do, and I appreciate that. I see the benefit. If we are going to lead the world in the success of each student, I see the benefit of this screener is that we know where each student is. I don't disagree with what Mr. Roberts said. I think if you can keep your kids at home in an environment where they're in a nurturing environment, I think that's great. And my own children were in that situation, and they turned out okay, despite their parents. But I see this as a benefit to make sure that we know where each child is so that we can meet their individual needs. And whether or not they stayed at home, it's great if that can happen, if it is a nurturing environment, and or if they went to a preschool, or if they went wherever, and whether or not that was a public or a private preschool is immaterial. If we're going to meet the needs of each child, we need to know where each child is. And so I'm going to support this for that reason. I think it gives us that data. That it gives us a starting point. And I'm like, okay, Ann.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I agree with Board Member Roberts as well. If kids, I think staying home and playing is great. There are a lot of parents who are natural teachers. There is nothing we have discussed today that goes against that. Kids, by law, can stay home till they're 18 and play. There is nothing in here we are prescribing for preschool whatsoever. It is totally up to the parents to decide to direct, to manage. So I would disagree with your premise that we're mandating any kind of preschool activity. The lady you talked with should be happy as clams with what we're talking about today. She can do whatever she wants with her kids. And when they turn five, by state law, you know, we say we want them in school. She doesn't have to do that either. But what we're talking about today is when they show up on our doorstep and we're responsible for them and we're responsible for making sure our Kansans Can vision works, the only way we know that is if we measure it. So if they show up on our doorstep, I think what we're voting on today is we want to know where they are, and the only way we can talk to our constituents in a rational way is to say, we have the data. Here's where they were, and 3 years from now, did we get any better at it? And so that's all we're talking about today. If they want to stay home and play, I'm good with that. I think that's awesome. So I just disagree that we're mandating anything or trying to make everybody fit in one box.
Mr. Chairman, I agree with everything you said, except the only way we can do it is to have the data. That's the part I disagree with. That's the only part of what you just said that I disagree with.
I have always been told that when the horse is dead, get off. So we're going to vote at this point. I believe the motion, could you put the motion back on the, even though we've got it here in front of us, I want to make sure that everybody knows exactly what we're voting for. And then there will be a vote again after the proposal is, request for proposal sent out, and we have a vendor, and if we don't like what we see, we vote again there. All in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. All opposed to the motion, please raise your hand. The vote is 7-1. The motion carries. You have anything else? Because you still have.
Oh, yeah, I've got more. Because we can talk a little bit about some of the early learning work that's going on, and I especially want to make sure that you're invited to our early learning roadshows. But if you do, you need a break, or how, what do you want to do with that?
Let's take a break.
Take a break. All right. Yeah.
We'll only take about a 10-minute break.
I love breaks.
And we'll reconvene whenever six of us are back in the room.
All right, well, we do have just a little bit of time left, and I just wanted you to be aware of the work that we're doing here at the agency to align around the kindergarten readiness outcome and to invite you to some opportunities that we have coming up going on around the state. I know that you all know this, but I thought you might find this slide helpful as you're talking to your constituents. And there's the data resource link for you on this slide that children at risk who do not participate in high quality early education programs are 50% more likely to be placed in special education, 25% more likely to drop out of school, 60% more likely to never attend college, 70% more likely to be arrested for a violent crime, and 40% more likely to become a teen parent. And if you would like more information about that, that link is there for you. And these are children at risk. So those statistics it's part of the Kids Count data book, and there's a lot of other interesting information there as well.
And Janet Wall has a question.
Oh, okay.
I guess I don't really have a question, I have a statement.
Okay.
I'm very well aware of this data, but I'm also very well aware of the fact that
many, many low socioeconomic students do not have access, and in fact have applied for, I represent KCK.
Yes.
And they turn students away.
Right.
Because they do not have the funding. So I guess what I would like to suggest, and I don't know that this is your responsibility or ours, but I think we ought to show this to the legislature. Thank you.
Definitely. So I wanted to just kind of show you a little bit. The top graphic shows where our early learning programs that KSDE oversees are currently.
What we have is parents, Kansas Parents as Teachers, which serves children and families when the children are prenatal through 2 years old. But as soon as the child turns three, Parents as Teachers can no longer work with that family. We have the Kansas Preschool Program.
Let me interrupt you there. That has been universally available until recently, correct? Parents as Teachers.
We're going to talk about.
Are you going to get to that?
We're going to get to
okay.
that.
Okay. Well, if not, I'm going to.
Okay. And then we have the Kansas Preschool Program and the State Pre-K that is just for four-year-olds. And then we have our K-12 education, ages 5 through 21, if need be. But what we want to move to is the bottom, and we believe that this will be really powerful. What we're moving to is extending the opportunity for Kansas Parents as Teachers programs to serve families of children prenatal to age 6, so that there isn't this gap and this breakup as far as, oh, we worked with you for a while and now we're dumping you, but really to work with a family until their child is well established into kindergarten. We want to take the Kansas Preschool Program and the State Pre-K and create what we're calling Early Learning Kansans, or ELKs, because we just can't possibly have another acronym that starts with a K, right? And that would be free for programs to serve 3-year-olds, 4-year-olds, and 5-year-olds that aren't quite ready or not quite old enough to go to kindergarten. So there would be a blending if need be, or if parents chose to do that. And then our Kansas K-12 system serves ages 5 through 21. Now, the reason we've got this to 8 years old kind of grayed out is that according to the National Association of the Education of Young Children and a lot of other literature, early learning really does go from birth to age 8. And we really need to get that message out that just because children show up in a different building doesn't mean their needs are tremendously different. So that is our work here at the agency. We're working to align all of these programs so that we don't have this gap in service. We know that there is a lot of work to do, and we know that there are not near enough preschool spots for all of the children in our state that want to go. But in order to impact it, we've got to clean our house here. And cleaning, to me, cleaning up means making it more aligned, making it consistent, instead of having siloed projects with different requirements, different measurements. So that is what our team has been working on. I wanted to also make you aware of the exciting conversations that have been going on around the state around kindergarten readiness and early learning because of kindergarten readiness being a board outcome. These are the conversations that districts are asking us as an agency for leadership. You know, how can we make sure our schools are ready for children? What is a quality early learning experience? What does a quality kindergarten program look like? How do we align early learning to K-12? These are really, really powerful questions that are happening at the local level and at the district level with community members. So it's been very, very exciting. And the answers to these questions are as various and different as every district and community in our state. So how districts choose to answer these questions is going to look different depending on where they're at and what their local resources are. But because we have had such an influx of questions from districts wanting help, and we're trying to figure out how to best facilitate these conversations. And so we have some early learning roadshows. And I have a flyer for you that has a little more information. And we would like to invite you to attend if there's one in your area. These early learning roadshows are going to be opportunities for districts to come with their district leaders, their early childhood leaders, their community partners, and have a facilitated conversation about what resources they have in their district, what they want early learning to look like in their communities, and we'll have partners there available to answer questions about funding, about Head Start rules and regulations, about transportation and busing,
all of the kinds of questions that come up when a district is wanting to begin something from scratch. And so we'll be in Oakley, we'll be in Girard, Hutchinson, Eudora, Topeka, and Garden City. And so not only do I encourage you to attend, but if you want more of these flyers and you want to hand them out as you're going around the state, Peggy can get those for you. It's going to be a really unique and exciting opportunity to answer their questions and really engage with the field. So we have a lot of early learning partners in Kansas. We've got our kindergarten readiness work group. We just convened the work group on full day kindergarten, where they were working to create a guide for programs that want to improve their full day kindergarten programs or to start full day kindergarten. We've got a team here at KSDE to support the work. We have our technical assistance system network, TASN, and they can help us with, when we talk about training and rolling something out, as far as professional learning, TASN is a very valuable asset that we have at our disposal to help us with that. The Kansas Parent Information Resource Center has been a very, very valuable partner. They produce the booklet Kindergarten in Kansas for parents. They partner with us on all of our work moving forward with early learning and kindergarten readiness. And then the Kansas MTSS system also supports early learning and kindergarten readiness in our state. So we've got a lot of friends. We've got a lot of partners. We've got a lot of people that are really, really interested invested in this work. And then here are our state early learning partners. And this is a really great graphic because it reminds us always that, you know, we are the State Department of Education, and we've got friends across the state in the Kansas Department of Health and Environment, the Kansas Children's Cabinet and Trust Fund, the Department of Children's Families, Head Start, Early Head Start, Child Care, and bringing all of these people together, all of these agencies together at the state level, and then at the local levels is what communities are looking towards to move this work forward. So I just wanted to let you know that it's a team effort. We've got lots of teams working on the behalf of young people in our state. And that's really it, just that little snippet at the end there. Our team is here to answer your questions, and of course our director, Colleen Riley, is also available to answer your questions.
Yeah, I understand, correct me if I'm wrong, that different early childhood programs are under the auspices of different state organizations.
That is correct. Mm-hmm.
And that last slide, you were talking about some of the, how's that coordination working?
We are working to build those relationships. Many of our kindergarten readiness work group members are from these different partnering agencies. And then when we roll out our early learning roadshows, we've got people from these different agencies that will be on hand and co-presenting with us during these roadshows.
So is that an improvement from the past?
I've only been in this position less than a year, so I can't speak to the relationships.
Can somebody else answer that question?
Vera will speak to this. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Vera Strout-Brontier, Mr. Chair, members of the board. I'm an assistant director on this same team, the Early Childhood Special Education and Title Services team. We have a long history at this agency of working in the area of early childhood, which you all know. We do have something at the state level called an Early Childhood State Leadership Team, where members of leads from our agencies across the agencies meet each month. And they talk to each other. I think that we're having a lot more discussions lately because of some things that have happened federally and statewide. One of them is the reauthorization of the Head Start performance standards and some of the work around the child care development funds. So, and we're having more districts tap into those funds because they're doing more work in the area of early learning. So we are having more discussions. I think districts are tending to be more invested and more, because of your initiative, more thinking about what can we do in our community, what can we do in our district to make sure that we shore up what's already happening. So because many districts already have in place our state pre-K program, and we've been serving students with disabilities in early childhood programs for 25 years. So
I've been an advocate of parent as teacher since it started in another state where I worked 30 years ago, and I'm very concerned that it is no longer, at least right now, available to anybody who wants it. Is there anything we can do to facilitate that?
We certainly do have a lot of work to do. I will say that as long as Parents as Teachers is being funded by the TANF federal dollars, those families have to meet certain risk factors, but local districts and local programs always have the freedom to serve families that don't meet those risk factors with local dollars. And so there's the rub. They need the local dollars in order to do that. So that's where we're at. But ideally, it would be great to expand Parents as Teachers and have that be available to every family that has children prenatal through age 6.
And it is voluntary. Nobody has to do it.
Yeah, it is voluntary. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Sally.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I really enjoyed your presentation. Thank you very much. When I travel around in the commissioner's car, we've been to several places, but I've ran into this. I'm just kidding on that. But I keep running into this time and time again, and it might be for your committee. The regulations or the facility requirements for if you have it in a, if you have a daycare or a preschool in this building, but if you have it over here in this building, or if you serve this type of kids, or if you serve, that is the hardest thing for people that want to do some good to follow. And if your committees on anything you're on can help us with that, because you actually do not have the dollars to go in and change these facilities. And you're shaking your head like you understand exactly what I'm saying, and that we want children to be safe, but there is no common sense to it. And it's like the people that go out and evaluate these buildings and these processes, they don't have any common sense to it. And that if they don't find something wrong, then they don't think they have a job. I mean, it's really bad out there.
Mr. Chair, if I may.
Because if you don't, I will.
So we do know that both child care and preschool programs have to be licensed by the Kansas Department of Health and Environment. And there, with some of the changes that have come down federally, there are going to be even more stringent requirements for licensing. Right now, school districts are exempt from that licensing. So if they have an early learning program in a district building, then they do not have to follow those same regulations, unless they're trying to combine their funds with Head Start or somebody who does have to be licensed. So there's a lot of pieces. So we are having some very intentional discussions, and not just within the context of that early childhood leadership team, but actually going right to the agencies and say, how can we make this better? Because it's not just ours to figure out. We have to talk to DCF. We have to talk to KDHE so that we can all fix it together.
We've tried to encourage Sally to be more transparent and more blunt, and she always hides her true feelings so well.
Well, I would just like to say that as we are trying to eliminate silos in towns by getting more community members involved to help us educate these children, those are barriers for us. Those are things that are keeping us in silos. And if I personally can help you, I won't put the whole board in, but if I can personally help you guys eliminate some of those, I would love to, because I have some towns wanting to do some awesome things. They can't do it.
Whenever you're meeting with your groups, are you having these sorts of conversations?
Yes, we are. Exactly. And the alignment, too, of our programs, which Tammy showed you earlier, will really help that, because when you align and you minimize the funding sources and the number of hoops that you have to jump, that helps with that. So it makes it much easier on districts.
Okay, we're going to bring this discussion to a close. We have one more question, and then you'll be the last one, and then we will move on. In that case, we thank you very much. We appreciate this. Appreciate the good work you're doing. Very excited about kids coming to school ready to learn and us knowing where they are so that we can do what's best for them, each individual child. Thank you. We're going to do some moving around, so we'll take another 15-minute break.
Thank you for this opportunity. Have a great day.